So, then maybe we can move on to the next talk from the professor the Herman van der Goot from the University of 20, and then he gives a talk with a title of Cooperative Balance Control of Exoskeleton. So, Professor.
Hey, good morning, good afternoon, good night, good evening. My name is Herman van der Kooi, and I want to thank the organizers for the invitation and also sort of give me the opportunity to share some of our work in the field of exoskeletons, and in particular on the balance control of those exoskeletons. This slide gives a bit an overview of the work we do in my group. So we're going to rehabilitation robotics, exoskeletons, prostheses, soft robotics, and robotic companions. And today I will talk about our work on exoskeletons. We design those exoskeletons ourselves, and also we develop controllers for those exoskeletons. In general, I think there are many different use cases for exoskeletons. I think the previous speaker already spoke about medical applications for rehabilitation, but they're also used for assistive device for people who had, for example, a spinal cord injury. But actually, they're also being used to prevent injuries for sports, but also in more industrial environments to prevent somehow the overloading of the musculoskeletal system by providing mechanical support to the trunk or the shoulder or the legs. And actually, there are different ways to control those exoskeletons. And this overview that I will now share with you is not complete, but of course there are many exoskeletons that are unpowered, so they don't need any control. Mainly those exoskeletons used to prevent injuries. Then there are exoskeletons that use path planning, planning of movements, especially those exoskeletons that are developed for a complete spinal cord injury subjects. But there are also other approaches, or I would say biological inspired approaches that somehow try to simulate the neuromuscular system. And again, other approach that we also developed is to control an exoskeleton as was your own muscle. So we call it this exomuscles. So then the actuator or the behaves in a kind of similar way as your own muscle. And also the control of your own muscle exoskeleton is quite similar. At least that is the idea. And if you then think about cooperative control, so that you want a situation where the control of the exoskeleton and your own body, your own muscles, is always acting together. You want to avoid that the device and the biological system are going to fight against each other, which we call cooperative control. Then those latter two options, they are very suitable for cooperative control. But if you think about the other approaches, so no control and planned motions, then it might be that for some specific motions, the exoskeleton and the biological system are, well, acting in synergy, but in many other cases, they will, kind of fight each other. So we believe that if you want to aim for cooperative control of exoskeletons and the human body, I have those kind of reflex-based neuromuscular control approaches, and also those kind of exomuscles, so that you try to activate those exoskeletons as it was your own muscle, they are very beneficial for cooperative control. And I would like to talk a bit more about those two approaches. So first of all, this kind of what we call EMG-driven musculoskeletal modeling. Actually, it's a framework developed by my colleague Massimo Sartori. It can be applied also for prostheses. And the idea is that you measure the muscle activities of the muscles that are supported by the exoskeleton. And then you use quite a complex and detailed model of your muscle dynamics. to predict the how much torque the muscles that do spin around a joint will exert. And that torque you then send to the low-level controller of the exoskeleton. And in such a way, the torque generated by the exoskeleton or your own muscle will be identical. Well, as you might know, those models are available. Now, for example, if you use the OpenSim framework, which you also use. But what is very important is to somehow tune the parameters in those models in such a way that they are accurate for each individual. So if you want to do this correctly, then you need to do a calibration of the model for each individual. And therefore you need a lot of experimental data of joint kinematics and kinetics, and then try to have a very good fit of this model so that the prediction of those torques in different kind of conditions are accurate. And this video shows you an idea how this that can be applied in the control of an exoskeleton. So it's an ankle exoskeleton. And in the top video, you see the torques. So the blue one, the torque of the exoskeleton, and in purple, the torque of the human. And you see that in case when assisted, the torque and comparative torque of non-assisted, the torque for the assisted walking, the biological torque, so human torque is reduced. Using this EMG-driven approach, using an accurate model of your muscle dynamics. And in fact, we evaluated this approach for different conditions, so different walking speeds, but also different inclinations of the surface. So we had slopes up to 5-12%, so ascending and descending. And we did evaluate how much the muscle activity reduced. So in those kind of stacked diagrams, you see the summed activity of the main plantar flexors and also tibialis. And then in purple, it's the total summed muscle activity of the non-assisted condition. And in blue, it's for the situation when it's assisted using this approach. And you see that in all those kind of conditions, you see a significant reduction. So apparently we are able to tune this model in such a way that with this control method, we could get a reduction over different conditions. So we had one model, so we didn't change the model for each condition. It was one model that was always operational in those different conditions, which was also effective in all those conditions. And even during transition, so if you had a transition from one condition to the other condition, we also found reductions in muscle activity. And that is quite different compared to other approaches that have been published and also are effective in somehow effectively supporting human gait, but they are always limited to one condition or at most two conditions. But if they then are being used for two conditions, then in most cases they use some kind of switching controller. So this is very promising, but in many cases, especially in cases where the EMG signal is not reliable, for example, or not available in severe injured patient groups like stroke survivors or paraplegics, you should find an alternative. And a way to find kind of a prediction of muscle activations is to make use of models that predict muscle activity. And actually, those models consist of all kinds of reflexes, which means that the human gait can be modeled and also human gait can be predicted by just a kind of model that includes muscle properties and all kinds of reflexes. And that was being proposed by Hartmut Geyer and Juher and also others. And in simulation, it showed to be quite effective to predict human kinematics and also the human the muscle activity patterns. And before, we also showed that using those this modeling framework, including reflexes, you can predict the joint torques and send this to an exoskeleton. And this kind of approach is also useful then to control an exoskeleton. And we did implement also this approach in an exoskeleton that was developed for incomplete spinal cord injured subjects. And here you see the results of somebody that can walk, but you also can see that without exoskeleton, he can walk very slowly. And on the right, you see this ankle knee exoskeleton with this kind of reflex-based models implemented. And you can see that patient walks much faster. And that's also what you see in this slide. So this is the data of one subject. And on the horizontal axis, you see the speed. Here you see the step length. This is data for walking without an exoskeleton. And then this person used the exoskeleton, and you see an increase in the speed and also the step length, which is, I think, quite remarkable because this exoskeleton is quite heavy. And also we see the same pattern in the second subject. So this is a green, the data of this person walking without an exoskeleton, and then with the exoskeleton and this control approach, you could walk much faster and also with large step length. And the nice thing here is also that you also can see that, well, the person is still able to choose his own speed. So you have a lot of freedom to move around and decide whether to want to stop or to accelerate. But the question, of course, because this topic is about balance control, so it's really nice that this approach somehow is working or effective if you just walk over ground. But it might be that somehow during daily life you are being perturbed, and then you should maintain balance. So if you want to apply those techniques in real life, then also this controller should somehow support balance. And for this reason, we apply perturbations during walking to study how people cope with those kind of perturbations and how do you retain balance. And the next step then is to compare the predictions of the model with the data that we collected from those kind of experiments. We compared then joint torques and also joint kinematics. And actually, if you then look at the data, it looks all pretty well, except for the activity around the calf muscles. So the predictions of the torques at the ankle after perturbations are far off from the kind of responses that we did measure during those experiments. So for that reason, we adopted the original framework developed, as I said, by Joher and Hartmut Geyer and colleagues, and added an additional reflex. And this reflex just uses the center of mass velocity. And you see here on the top panel, what is the kind of variation of the horizontal center of mass velocity. In blue, the normal pattern, and in red, the pattern if you are being perturbed. So as you might could expect, if you are perturbed somebody forward, you should get an increase in the center of mass velocity. And actually, with a kind of, it's kind of doable to then calculate the kind of center of mass velocity error. And use this error to change the activation of the ankle muscle, torque. So it means that the ankle torque is also dependent on the deviation of the center of mass velocity. And then what we did is we did compare the original model, so without this additional reflex, with the model where we included this reflex. Well, here you see the data of the ankle joint. So the first column are the, is the data of unperturbed walking. Then the second column is data of when you got a backward perturbation. And the third column is when you got a forward perturbation. And then you always see in black the human data, so the human response. And then in red, the original model, which was optimized in such a way to get as close as fit as possible. And then in blue, the extended model, including this additional reflex. And you can see that actually the original model actually is far off from the human response. In fact, it doesn't really, well, help you to maintain balance, but actually it even somehow enforce or makes the perturbation stronger. So it has the opposite effect. While we have, where we extended the model with this additional reflex, that we got a response that is more human-like and also did help to maintain a balance. So what next step then was to see whether this kind of new extended reflex-based model could also be is also effective if you would implement it in an exoskeleton controller. So again, here you see a movie of a subject wearing this exoskeleton. Also in the back, you see that there is some kind of device, and it's kind of haptic device that just pushes this subject forward. And then, with this, we implemented just this kind of controller that I just introduced. So it measures the center of mass velocity. It calculates the deviation from what you would see in unperturbed walking. And this deviation then is used to control the ankle torque. And actually control is quite simple. It's just proportional to this kind of center of mass velocity deviation. So this is the torque response. So it's the torque exerted by the exoskeleton. So in red here you see what happens if you are unperturbed. So there's hardly any torque exerted. And then if you are being pushed forward, you see that the exoskeleton gives a kind of support torque to compensate for this perturbation. And this data then shows the EMG data. So it's not the total EMG data, but only the EMG that is somehow reflecting the response of this balance perturbation. And this is activity of the soleus muscle. So you see a reduction if you compare the no assist in black with the assist condition, about 9 to 50%. If you have the perturbation at the end of the swing phase, and if you have it at the begin, or the end of double support phase, we also see a reduction, although a bit smaller. And if you do this, if you look at the data of the gastromedialis, we also see significant reductions in those muscle groups. Well, it's nice it works in healthy subjects. And we also want to try to see whether those kind of controls are effective in patients. So this is an experiment that we did where we had this incomplete spinal cord subject standing in exoskeleton. And we implemented a similar controller also using the center of mass position and velocity to get controllers that are supporting balance. And what you see here, if you implement those controllers, that if you look at those three different patients and compare the yellow response data, which is the data of this controller, and compare with the blue response, you always see that the body sway after this perturbation is much smaller. So it's very effective. And pilot three, this person could even not stand without such a controller. So he really was relying on this type of controller. So it also seems that this kind of controllers that use center of mass velocity to maintain balance are effective. So in conclusion, cooperative biological inspired controller for exoskeletons are intuitive and effective. We see that a reduction in G over a variety of walk conditions with those EMG driven muscles, muscle skeletal models in healthy individuals. And we also can improve balance in those patients and also in healthy subjects with a controller that uses the center of mass velocity to adjust its ankle torque of the exoskeleton. And this work was done with many collaborators and with the help of many PhDs and postdocs, technical support, and of course also the test pilots, which of course I would like to acknowledge.